Okay, hey there guys. I've chosen to do a video, a tutorial about fixing a roofing leak repair today on an S-tile roof. And you can see that this tile is out of place. It is now over there. It slid down and exposed the felt paper here and has basically deteriorated the felt paper inside there, and it runs down underneath the tile down slope and is reaping havoc down there on the exterior wall above the header to the slider down below. So anyways, I'm going to go through a step-by-step process showing you how I do a leak repair on a tile roof like this. So the first thing I do is I come one row up from where the leak begins, and I come over a couple of tiles, and I'm going to pull on that tile, that tile, that tile, that tile, and that tile, and loosen them up a little bit. So I get the nail that's holding these in place a little bit loose. So I get my flat bar underneath of it and then pull that nail out and then slide these tile out. After that, I will continue to take the tile out alongside the leak and then the tile out down below the leak. Stack the tile off to the side. Assess how bad the felt paper is. Replace the felt paper under here every place where it's bad. Tuck the felt up underneath the good felt above the leak and put the tile back in. So I've already loosened all these tile up here, and I'm going to go ahead and pull the nails out and start pulling the tile out of this area and coming down, and I'm going to stack it off to the side. I'll be right back. All right, so I have separated this tile with my flat bar. So I get my hammer under it. I take my hammer, I slide it under right there, and I turn the handle to hold that tile up, okay? Just like that, okay? That's how I separate them. Then I can use my flat bar to get underneath that, see that nail in there? I don't know if you can see it or not. No, it's kind of hidden. Okay, so anyways, I'm gonna get my flat bar underneath that nail head and just pop that nail head up. I'm gonna take the other end and do the same. Until that nail's out, and that begins the process of pulling the nails out of there. Okay, I'll do the same with all these coming across here up above the leak. So let me get them out of there and I'll be right back. All right, so you can see just how large this leak was, and I've cut the felt paper out all the way to the rafters. Fortunately, it is 16 inches on center from rafter to rafter, so I'm gonna end up replacing the plywood sheeting in here because it's obviously damaged with 2 4-foot wide panels, and then I'll block the seams in the middle and nail them off on the rafters here. But I've got to cut all this wood out, so I cut the felt out far enough to get to those rafters so I can pull the nails and get this old wood out of here and put the new wood in. This is the felt that I will be using when I do the repair after I get the wood back in. This is 30-pound ASTM rated felt paper, and this is more than sufficient to do a repair for the underlayment underneath a tile roof. Now, 15-pound ASTM is typical for composition shingles, whereas 30-pound ASTM is typical and sufficient for tile. Original installation or repairs. Now, a lot of contractors will try to sell the homeowner a premium rated felt paper, which is not necessary. And I have learned over the years that the primary reason why they do that, why they try to upsell the underlayment, is because they don't have confidence in their guys to install the tile properly. This leak is an example of a bad installation. Somebody neglected to nail that tile. Now, it was probably broken at one time during the installation and somebody replaced it. But when they replaced it, they obviously can't nail it because the nail hole is hidden up underneath there. So they were supposed to glue it in place and they neglected to glue it. This is the typical lack of quality control you see in most roofing contractors, and this is a result of bad installation, bad labor, and this is why they try to upsell the underlayment, not because the underlayment is sufficient or is not sufficient. So let's come up here, I'll show you the underlayment after 2 decades of wear and tear, you can see it is still in perfect condition where there is nothing wrong. Okay, this is plenty thick, it's flexible, and this will last anywhere from 50 to 100 years provided your tile is installed properly. But when it is not installed properly, that's when you end up with the felt paper wearing out. And that's what the other contractors are trying to prevent from happening. Instead of making their guys do the installation correctly, instead of sending a supervisor out on the job to make sure they do it right, they just upsell the homeowner on the underlayment. So enough about that. It's just one of my pet peeves. I despise that fact. And I wish that more contractors would take more pride in their work and make sure that the customer doesn't have to pay for things like this in the future, and not have to pay for premium underlayment, because they really don't need it, provided things are done correctly. So enough about that. Once I get this all cut out of here and head off to the store, I'm going to get a couple of panels, and then I'll come back, put this in, and I'll be back on camera to show you the nailing pattern on the plywood, and then we'll get the felt back in and start the installation or reinstallation process. I'll be back. All right, so here I have 2 2x4 foot panels here stacked on top of each other. They're right over the opening where I need to replace the rotted wood. So all I'm going to do now, you see I've laid them out and they are right on the rafter. You see the nail here right on the rafter. So I've aligned this edge with the rafter. I've aligned the other edge with the rafter. And now all I need to do is take a Sharpie and go ahead and draw a line on the outside of these. I don't even have to snap a line. Just draw a line on the outside of them with a Sharpie, and then follow up by cutting right along that line with my saw. Okay, so I'm going to mark all around the perimeter with the Sharpie on the old wood, and then I just cut it out, and then the new panels will fit right in the opening. All right, I'll be back at the next step. All right, so there you can see I've got everything open. A rafter system, 16 inch on center. So 3 rafter bays is a total of 48 inches wide, which is exactly the width of my panels. So I'm going to go, and you can see that cutting them out where I did, you have a little lip right here where the new panels can sit down on there, and I can stitch nail both sides of this just like I would the original sheeting when I'm sheeting an entire roof. So I'll go ahead and put those panels in, I'll nail them off, I'll show you the nailing pattern, and I'll be right back. Hey there, I just remembered something else. Before I nail these off and show you the nailing pattern on these plywood panels, I just wanted to point something out. A lot of times this space right in here with the half inch plywood on the roof is very flexible when you have these smaller panels that you're putting in place. But the reason why it's normally very flexible and unstable is because typically you don't have a roof rafter system that is 16 inches on center like this one. Normally your rafters are about 24 inches on center, and there's a lot more space between the rafters to allow for a flexibility right in here when you step on it. But what I'll show you is that, you see this? There is virtually no flexibility in between these rafters. And these panels are not even nailed off yet. Once they're nailed off, they'll be even more stable. So I'm not going to put any blocking on the back side of these lateral seams in between the rafters. Oftentimes I do when these panels sit on 24 inch span rafters, okay? And so that blocking on the back side, I just screw through the panel, I pull the blocking tight from the back side, and then I screw through this panel into the blocking as well, and it stabilizes these joints in between the rafters. So you may need to do that if you're replacing panels on your on your rafters or on your roof where the rafters are 24 inches on center, from rafter to rafter, 24 inches. These are not, these are only 16 inches on center, much more solid for the plywood, so I'm not going to be blocking them. I just wanted to point that out. Okay, so I'll be back when I do the nailing pattern. All right, so as far as nailing pattern goes, probably a good idea for you to check your local codes at your local building and safety division of the entity, city, county, wherever you live. But in my area, the perimeter nails, anywhere you have a seam along the rafters, the exterior perimeter of that panel needs to be nailed 6 inches on center minimum. So these are all 6 inches apart. Same thing on the other side of the cut, all 6 inches on center. Every 6 inches, you get another nail on both sides of the seam, okay? Same thing over there, same thing. Every 6 inches, okay? On the perimeter, on the seam of the board or the perimeter. And then here in the middle of the panel, obviously you can't nail along here because there's nothing underneath here. So these do not require nails. That's in between the rafter there. But here in the middle on the rafter, you want the nails to be every 9 inches minimum. So these are about 7 or 8 inches apart. So here you have one, another, another, another. So these need to be about 9 inches apart. And these on the outside edge need to be 6 inches apart. And I've found this to be more than sufficient with half inch sheeting on just about any truss or rafter system that I've ever worked on. All right, I'll get back to you when I get to the next step, putting in the felt. Okay, so there you can see I've got all the new felt paper in. I probably over nailed it quite a bit, but a lot of times when I do these repairs, the point is this: I don't want the customer to ever have another problem in this area again. So I know it's overkill for this area, but the last thing I want on a leak that I warranty against is for the customer to have another problem in the same area. So I over nail it. I make sure the felt is lapped properly. I like to have about 8 inches of side lap here where the new felt overlaps the old felt. And so you can see that I've tucked the felt way inside there. Same thing on the other side. I've gone in as far as I could and nailed it along the edge, so I got a good overlap. Now up under here, this piece here tucks underneath this course where the old stuff was, right under there. And then this one here tucks up underneath the old one on the outside edges. Same thing on that edge too. This piece tucks up underneath the course of felt above, including the old felt that I'm covering up with the next sheet. And then up here, I got a lot, significant amount of underlap from this piece, goes all the way up inside there, about 6 inches. So in this case, I actually get away with not having to mastic these nail holes up underneath here. Normally, if I only have a 2-inch lap here, I would have had to come in here with some Henrys and mastic these nail holes before I put the last course in. But since this new felt tucks underneath here a good 6 to 8 inches, I don't have to do that. It's waterproof just as it is. So, because of the overlap. Okay, so there's all the new felt in. You can see I've overlapped the bird stop down here. And you still have the nail holes, the weep holes, so any water can still get out. Before I put the felt on, though, I went ahead, because this bird stop was a little flimsy, and especially on the S tile, the higher profile tile, the tile tends to slide a little bit over time this way, and it kind of pushes your bird stop out. So once again, I know it's probably overkill, but I went ahead and I nailed the bird stop underneath this felt. I nailed some 8D nails through the bird stop down into the fascia board all the way across here to tighten up this bird stop and bring it back a little bit, make it a little more true and upright. So when I put the first course of tile back in there, they don't slide. It's more firm and it resists sliding a little bit better. So that's it. All I got left to do is to put the tile back in. There's my tile. Pulled the nails, stacked it nice and clean. It's ready to go. for reinstallation. And that's about it. I'll get back when I get to the next step. Okay, so as you can see, I'm putting the tile back in. And I just ran across a little something I thought you might appreciate, a little tip. The overlap here, right in here, where this course overlaps this course, is a little bit narrow on this particular course. All the other previous courses, it was sufficient, about 3.5 inches. But this one's getting a little thin, and you can see where the water has been dripping real close to this nail hole. And I turned one of these tiles over, and I looked on the bottom side of it, and you can see there's a little bit of, well, not on that one, but on one of these tile where the course was a little shy like this, you could see the water streak running down the underside of the tile where water was actually dripping in through the nail hole as the water runs down these series of pans here. So one little trick you can do, there's not a lot you can do about the layout and the overlap of the tile once your roof is installed, without re-roofing the whole house. So if you're still getting penetration, water penetration through the tiles, some areas, not over your whole roof, because then it's probably time just to re-roof it. But in a couple local areas or one particular area, what you can do is after you nail this tile in place, you can just put a little dollop of sealant on there, like silicone or a tripolymer or something like that, before you put the next course of tile over the top of that. And then as the water drips off of the tile above, it cannot get through that nail hole and seep through and rot out your felt. Just another tip. All right, I'll be back once I get the rest of the tile in. Okay, not quite done yet, but I ran into a problem that I thought you guys might want a little tip on. See this nail hole here? It is way too thick. The manufacturer's nail hole, I cannot break through it with a 10D nail without breaking the tile. So I don't want to break the tile, but I can't nail it. So what do? I glue it. And let me show you where the best place is that I've found in 29 years of doing this, where the best place is to glue these, okay? You want to glue it to the tile below that is nailed down, okay? I'm going to put in my flat bar right in there, okay? Lift the tile up a little bit. In fact, why don't I know I have some sealant underneath here on the nail hole, so I want to be careful not to get my bar into that sealant up in there. Okay, so I've got the bar in there separating the tile. You want to glue it here on this, on where it touches the top of this tile here to the bottom corner of this tile. This is really tight inside here. So you want to put a little dollop in there, and you want to put some right in here where it sits on top of that tile. That is the tightest place where it won't impede water flow and will really stick well to the tile below it, which is nailed in place. Don't try and glue it to the tile above. It will pull out over time. But if you glue it to the tile below that's nailed, it will not slide down again. You will literally have to cut that sealant out of there. And I'm just using a standard tripolymer. It's by Novalink. Good construction adhesive, sealant, caulking. It's great for all construction materials, including cement tiles, metal flashing, brick, mortar, etc. So I just wanted to show you guys that. That's a nice little tip I've learned over the years when you cannot nail a tile, because if you try to, you'll just simply break it. All right, so I'll be back when I get the rest of the tile in. Not much more to go. Got 10 tiles to go. I'll show you how to tuck the last course. So here we go, I'm putting in the last course here, and as you can see, where these tile will be sitting on top of these tile, which are nailed, you can't nail these, you have to glue these in because they're tucking underneath the ones above. You can't get a nail through here because the nail hole is covered by the next course up there. Make sense? So this course has to be glued to the course below, which is nailed. 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 See that? So I'm cleaning the top of this tile right there where the two meet, right there where the next one will be sitting on top of that, right there where the next one will be sitting, and right under there where this one will be sitting on top of that tile. So I've slid my flat bar up under here to separate the tiles so I can slide my tile up underneath there. I'll put a little dollop of sealant here, here, and there. Tuck these last three in, pull my bar out. Everything will set down nice and tight. They'll all be glued in and we'll be done. I'll be right back. Okay, so there you go. I've put the last three tiles in. Let's go ahead and pull my flat bar out. You'll see the ones on top sit down nicely. And now this row here has been glued in, tucked and glued, so it won't be going anywhere in probably the next 20 or 30 years. So that concludes our tutorial on our tile roofing leak. I will blow all this off. Had a couple of cracked tile that I cannot replace anymore because thanks to Life Tile, they've changed their molds. Okay, they changed the shape of their tile. These are no longer available. So I had a crack in that one I had to seal up with some sealant. A crack in that one that I had to seal with sealant. So I've got some terracotta paint that I will spray on those two areas to blend all the color after I finish blowing this section off. Now that we're done, I'll be back after I clean it up and paint those details, and it's on the way home. I'll be right back. Okay, so I'm all finished. There's the entire leak area right there. You see the two spots where I've painted. That's terracotta paint. Give it a few months and that paint will mellow and fade to match the oxidized color of the existing roof tiles. A couple of them over there too, one there and one on the other side of the ridge. Also, I blew out this valley because, actually both valleys, because they were completely packed with debris from these pepper trees and the other trees growing around the residence. So you want to keep those valleys cleaned out. I scraped them out with a flat bar and then I blew them out with a leaf blower. Had to make about five or six passes to get all the dirt out of there. And now I have the fun task of cleaning up the ground because there's tons of debris down there. I've also got to cut up the plywood sheets, as you can see them way down there. Those need to be cut up and put in the trash can as well. So I still have that to do. But I wanted to leave you with one quick tip. I've been walking on S tile, on concrete tiles, now for nearly three decades. And I'm only 145, 150 pounds, so I'm a fairly lightweight guy, but you can still break tile if you're not careful. So I just wanted to show you how I walk on these tile. And I know this is kind of counterproductive to point this out at the end of the video. However, you can use this technique, walking on tile, the next time you have to get on your roof. So what I do is I typically will stand down here on the overlap. This tile below comes all the way up into here underneath this tile. So you have about 3 or 4 inches of overlap here. That is double thickness. You have this tile and that tile stacked on top of each other. So this bottom section of every tile is the strongest place to walk on. Same thing here, right in here. You want to put your foot on this area here, or on this area here. So you try to walk down on the bottom edge of these tiles, not right on the edge, but about 3 or 4 inches. And what you do is you span your foot across two crowns like that at a time. This distributes your weight on two crowns instead of on one. If you put all your weight on one, it's very easy to break the tile. So put your foot across two, just like that, and walk across the roof like that. And I'll show you, it can be done. I suppose I will do it while holding the camera. So you just go like that all the way across the roof. You try to keep your feet down on that bottom portion, spanning across two crowns at a time. Don't step down in here. Do not step here. Don't step here. Step across two crowns down near the bottom edge where they overlap. All right, so that's it for the tutorial. Thanks for watching. I'll see you out there on YouTube. Dan out.